All right, hello everyone. Today I have a very special guest. His name is Nathan Hirsch, and he is the founder of FreeUp.com, which is a service that allows you to outsource and find other freelancers to help you automate and scale your business so that you don't have to spend hours and hours working and trying to do everything in your business alone. Welcome. Welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to be here. I love talking hiring. I love talking freelancers and outsourcing.
Awesome. So let's talk about, Nathan, a question that I'm always getting asked in my community, which is, you know, we'll go into it a little bit more and talk about your company, but tell us what the benefits are of outsourcing as a small business owner, especially if you have like a consulting company or an agency model for your business.
Yeah, so if you're not outsourcing, if you're not hiring remote workers, you're really limiting yourself. And you're limiting yourself to not only the talent around you that is in your town or maybe the towns next to you, but you're also competing with all the other businesses in the same area for that same talent, making the supply go down pretty quick. And in addition to that, you get people jumping around, going from company to company. The prices tend to go up. When you open yourself up to outsourcing, you get access to talent from all around the world at different price points, different specialists, people that you don't have to hire full-time, people that you can hire for one-time projects or a few hours a week, maybe half-time, 20 hours a week, whatever it is. And you can really customize your remote team to fit your needs and grow your remote team over time without having to compete with all the businesses around you for all that local talent.
That's awesome. So tell us about you and how you started FreeUp and what does FreeUp do?
Yeah, so I started my first business when I was in college. I was a broke college kid looking for extra beer money on the side. And I started buying and selling people's textbooks. I started to cut off the bookstore because I thought they were ripping me off. And before I knew it, I had lines out the door of people trying to sell me their books. And you don't sell books for very long without learning about Amazon. So I started selling the books on Amazon and I became addicted to it, obsessed with it. All I wanted to do was become a really high-end Amazon seller. I saw the potential. And this was back when Amazon was just getting over just being a bookstore and they were starting to branch out into other things, if you can imagine that. So I started playing around with different products, different things I liked, sporting equipment, DVDs, computers, and I failed over and over and over, and the only thing I could sell were books. So one day I was browsing along some deal sites trying to find some products for me personally, and I came across this baby product, and it was on sale for half off. It was one of these toy laptops, and I had the idea to drop ship this baby product on Amazon, and I started doing that and it sold and I kept selling more. I started doing research for other products. And before I knew it, I was running this multi-million dollar Amazon baby dropshipping business out of my college dorm room. So like other entrepreneurs, as your business starts to grow and you see success and you start making money, you get overwhelmed pretty quick. And I was completely overwhelmed. I was going to college. I had a girlfriend. I was balancing that with the business and everything I wanted to do in my personal life, and I needed help to get that stuff done. So I started hiring people, and I hired my first employee before I could legally drink, and it was my business partner, Connor, who's been working with me for 8 years. So I got really lucky and made a really good hire, but after that, there were a lot of bad hires as well, people that wasted my time, my money. And as I continued to learn about hiring and getting better and better at it and growing my business, I learned about outsourcing, the remote world, the Upworks, the Fivers of the world, and I became addicted to that. I called it my VA army. I wanted to outsource my outsourcing. And one thing I learned as I was doing that and I was hiring really talented people from all over the world, it took up so much of my time. I went from doing the things I really liked, which was marketing, sales, processes, systems, to posting jobs, doing interviews, evaluating, meeting with people, and I just wanted there to be a faster way to get talent. So that's when I came up with the idea of FreeUp, where we get hundreds of applicants every week. We vet them not only for their skill, but their attitude and their communication. We take a top 1%, let them in, and then make them available quickly to people all around the world as they grow their business, so they spend less time searching for talent and more time using that talent to expand their business and grow further.
Yeah, so that is I'm so glad that you explained that process of how you started your business. You started making a lot of money and you were overwhelmed. And this is a common theme I see with business owners. They are starting out, you know, we're all bootstrapping our businesses, right? A lot of us don't have investors. And so, you know, it is possible for you to go from one, you know, business owner and scale your business to multi six figures, millions, and also grow a team without investment, right? But in that process, you're doing everything yourself. So if you have a marketing agency or a social media agency or some type of consulting, in that type of business model, you're doing a lot of service work. And I, you know, so many people want to start outsourcing. So can you tell us in your specific situation, after you were able to hire Connor, who was like a great hire for you and it worked out well because now you guys work together, he's a partner. How was it after that? Like, what were some of the issues you had with finding the right team members, and then how did you find a better system for that?
Definitely. Before I do that, can you check and make sure the Facebook Live is working? Because I'm not seeing it on my end. I just want to make sure before we go.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Let me just make sure. Because, you know, Facebook Lives, of course. Yep, we're live. We're live.
Cool.
We got some people looking.
Just making sure. Cool. So yeah, one thing that I realized, so I had to start hiring, right? I knew that I needed these people. Without these people, I was going to fail. I was going to be overwhelmed. My life was going to be miserable. So I went out with the mentality like, please work for me. Please work for me. I need you. I need you. I need you. And people, when you're going from a place of need, a lot of times you run into people that they don't need you as much as you need them. So you're hiring these people that, hey, I need you to do customer service, you need to do orders, but they're doing it not because they need a job, not because they care about the company. Maybe they just need an extra paycheck, or maybe they wanted to just try it out. They're not seriously committed. And once I realized that I was getting people that it was almost like me begging people to work for me, and that wasn't working because I was getting people that weren't motivated. They cared about school more than they cared about business, that maybe their parents were wealthier. They didn't really need a side job, whatever the reason was. And it kind of clicked into my head that I need to find people that need me more than I need them. Or people that maybe they need the money, that they're desperate for that job. They're passionate about e-commerce. They wanted to learn about Amazon. Whatever the reason was, I need to be a little bit less beggy and more like, hey, I have this opportunity that's out there. I need to find people that want this opportunity, that will do anything for this opportunity. And that's very similar to how we find people for FreeUp. We want people who want to be freelancers. They need a job. They want to grow their business. They want to be a part of something. And we don't want people who are just like, I'll try it out. I'll see if I like it. I'm not sure if freelancing is for me, or yeah, this sounds like something good, but the second I get a better opportunity, I'm out the door. So if you're a business owner, you have an opportunity. You have a job. Nowadays, it's hard to find a job for people that are not entrepreneurs that are actively looking for gigs, for freelance work. And if you have an opening, you have to find someone that will do anything possible to fill that opening. And a lot of times that's what leads to the good hire, because you find someone who's passionate and really wants to be there.
Yes, and Nathan, you mentioned something that only people really experience with outsourcing, like yourself. And I've been doing outsourcing for almost 10 years. For my own business. I mean, literally, I've tried so many different ways to find people. And I do agree with you that to have a successful team, you want to hire people who really take it serious. Like, this is their full-time job for them. Or, you know, even if you're like one of their clients, they still treat it like, you know, you don't even know. You think they're the only client, right? Because they just treat you so well because they take their work really serious. And so, that is one of the challenges. And I have a lot of people in my community say, you know, I try to hire people and it's like, it doesn't work. And so as a business owner, you are a manager, right? In your business. So knowing how to hire the right people, see if it's a good fit, screen them, And once you do find someone great, knowing how to manage that and make sure that you're meeting, you know, your business objectives and helping that person have the information. So can you kind of give us that process as to, you know, in your experience, which is vast, how did you find a good system to manage those people and really help your team put out good work?
Yeah, it's all about setting expectations up front. I have clients that'll come to me, excuse me, and they'll say, hey, like, I've been working with this VA outside of FreeUp. I've had him for 4 or 5 months. It's just not working out. We're not on the same page. This is a bad experience. Like, what would you do in this situation? And I always start with being like, no one would ever work for me for 4 months before I figure out that they're a bad fit for me. That's that. You have to come up with a better upfront process of setting expectations and figuring out whether they're a good fit right away. You have to look at hiring as an investment. You're going to invest your time, your money, your energy into these people. Whether there's a long onboarding process or not, you still are going to do that. So when I interview someone, and let's say they pass my interview and I'm giving them a chance, I set the expectations so they're black and white. This is how we communicate. These are what the goals are. This is what's expected of you. This is who you go to for XYZ. One of the things I expect is I want feedback and ideas. I want them to come every day trying to improve. And so I lay out what those expectations are, and I don't give them a very big window. I can find out if someone's going to be good or not within a few days, not a few months. And too many people, they let it drag on. They think that just because they've invested time into interviewing or they've invested a few hours in onboarding them, that now they have to commit for months down the line. And no, you have to look at it like a real investment. I don't want to invest more into someone if I haven't invested that much upfront. Now, if I've already invested a lot of time into someone, yes, it makes sense to do everything possible to have them turn around and get them on the right track. And if not, you have to come up with an alternative plan. But too many people, they don't cut bait early and make a change before they kick in that investment.
That is so true. So I personally, I could tell within, like you said, the first 2 or 3 days, if they're going to work out or not. I mean, you can see the signs right there. You can tell. And so one of the frustrations a lot of people have is that they go on different platforms to try to find people, and they have these problems. So, you know, trying to find out if the person is qualified, to make sure they have the right skill set. What type of things do you look for, like specific? So I'll just give you mine. So, you know, as an example, I look for, number one, your portfolio. Like, if I'm hiring someone for website design or social media management, I want to see what websites you designed, what social media accounts you were able to help. And so if the red flag is if they can't give me any portfolio, well, I'm like, well, then you must not have experience. And I typically try to hire people with experience, but there are some times where, in some cases, if I have a team in place and maybe I'm just going to hire someone else, I've sometimes let people just learn with us. But in the beginning, you need people to have experience because you don't have time to waste training a lot of times. So you do need to look for portfolios, samples of work. The other thing I look for is, okay, so once you've proven to me you have a portfolio, then if I give you an assignment, what is the communication? So are you going to communicate with me the progress, or are you going to tell me if you didn't meet the due date? Like if I say, okay, we need this done in a week, and Friday comes and there's no email from you, to me that's a red flag. At least say if I can't make Friday, hey, I need more time. We'll get this done for you Monday or Tuesday. Like, that's my personal thing. You know, it's communication, it's follow-up. I mean, that is so important when you're working with a remote team, people who are not face-to-face. In my experience, you need to have that communication constantly. So what is, do you have any specific things that you do, examples to share as well, similar to that?
Yeah, so we get hundreds of applicants every week. We reject 99 out of every 100 applicants, and we're taking the top 1%, letting them in, and it's all based on 3 things. It's the skill, which you mentioned, the communication, which you mentioned, and attitude. And so when we're talking about skill, every skill set's different, right? If they're a graphic designer, we're looking at their portfolio, we're looking at their past work. If they're a web developer, we have a web dev test they take. If they're an Amazon expert, well, we have an Amazon expert that helped us create questions that we want to ask them to figure out what their expertise is. Are they a 10 out of 10? Are they a 5 out of 10? And sometimes it doesn't matter if they're a 10 out of 10 or a 5 out of 10. What's important is that you know who is a 10 out of 10, who's a 5 out of 10, because clients can use them in different roles, in different places. So skill depends on what you're going for, but the attitude and the communication is the same no matter who I work with or no matter who we let into the marketplace. So with attitude, I want someone who's passionate about what they do, someone who comes up with a smile on their face, someone who genuinely enjoys the work that they're doing. I hate bookkeeping. If I hire a bookkeeper, they have to love bookkeeping as much as I love being an entrepreneur. Those are the type of people that I want to surround myself with. Because we've all worked with someone, whether it's an office space or a remote team, that comes in with a bad attitude every day, that every day they're having a bad day, no matter what happens, and they bring the whole morale down. People lack motivation, lack focus when they're dealing with people like that or interacting with people like that. And then, I mean, communication is everything. Like you just said, it doesn't matter what the attitude is or the skill. If we can't communicate on the same and get on the same page, it's never going to work out. So we have 15 pages of communication best practices that freelancers have to memorize and get tested on before they get into the marketplace. And that's stuff like you said, where it's, hey, if you're not going to miss a meeting, if something comes up, I better know about it well in advance of the meeting. You shouldn't be telling me 2 hours later after you blew me off, oh, sorry, there was an emergency. You should be responding within a business day. You should be able to give and hit estimates. Obviously, they have to speak English, but that's not really what we're talking about. We only hire people that can communicate in terms of language at a high level. It's much more advanced and in-depth than that. We don't want clients chasing someone across the U.S. or chasing someone across the Philippines to get a hold of them. We want people that are proactive. So it's all about making sure you have that full triangle of skill, attitude, and communication, and you're not just getting someone that has one or two out of the three.
Exactly. So what tools do you use to manage your team? Like there's so many tools. I love Trello. I do like Asana too, but I kind of lean a little bit towards Trello just because I'm used to it. What tools or, you know, systems do you use to manage a team if you have special projects or just ongoing work?
Yeah, so I use Skype. Skype is huge. It's the best way to communicate with people internationally, in my opinion. You can create group chats. You can chat one-on-one. You can make phone calls if you want to. I use Trello to handle short-term and long-term projects. And when I'm dealing with my team members, they always have three things. They have their day-to-day operations, whatever they're doing for me consistently, whether it's monitoring my emails or maintaining our social media. Then they have short-term projects that they're working on, and then they have long-term projects that they're working on, usually when it's a slower week. So I use Trello to manage not only my own projects in that way, but also they have their own Trello boards to manage theirs as well. When you're dealing with developers, because we have our own software for the marketplace, we use Jira, which is a much more advanced Asana project management tool that developers seem to really like. And outside of those, I mean, those are really the key. You don't need a lot to manage your remote team. I have 20 people, and just by using the Skype, Trello, and Jira, I'm able to manage them pretty well. And I know a lot of my clients that use virtual assistants will use Slack or the Asana, which I've actually never used. But for me, if I can keep it as simple as possible, if I can onboard them quickly and make sure they're on the same page, to me, that is a little bit of a benefit, because there's just less moving parts, less moving around, less time getting them used to the custom. And it really depends on the streamline and how big your organization is.
Yeah. Oh, this is awesome. I love some of the tips you gave, because I actually come from the tech world and we use Jira for development for software, I love Jira as well. And Jira and Trello are like the same company now, so, which is kind of cool.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, they actually bought them out, I believe. Yeah. So touching on that point, what would you recommend? So if someone comes in and uses freeup.com to hire team members, what would you say, how should they set up a system to train those people, maybe get them into their process? What would you recommend?
Sure. So it really depends on what level you're going for. So we like to say that there's three levels. You've got basic level, mid-level, expert level. So the basic level are $5 to $10 an hour, non-US. They're there for clients that have their systems, have their processes in place. And if you don't have your systems or processes in place, you really shouldn't hire a basic or lower level worker until you build out those systems, unless you are good enough where you can actually hire them to help create the systems with you and update it over time, which is something that I've used to just help me save me time. So for those types of workers, I always recommend a training document or onboarding document. With that, and the reason for that is, a lot of times if you're a startup, the processes you have are gonna change and evolve over time. It's very rare that in year one, you're like, boom, this is the hard process. It's not changing for the next 10 years. Usually it evolves and changes. And when you make videos, every time something changes, you have to go in and recreate the video or edit the video. And it's much better to have a document and only put it and continue to update the document and even have the VAs every time you come up with a process change, make it one of their responsibilities to keep that document updated, that then to have videos and continue wasting time over and over and over. The videos really should come once you're set in stone on what your processes are. So that's for the basic and lower level. The mid-level people are more specialists. So they might be graphic designers, writers, bookkeepers. You're not really teaching them, although you can tweak what they're doing to fit your needs and give them feedback. And they're not really consulting with you either. They're doers. They do the same thing 8 to 10 hours every day. You're hiring them for that expertise. And then you've got the experts. So you've got the $20 to $50 an hour range. They can consult. They can project manage. They can help you create and build the systems and processes for the basic level people. And they can also execute high level things, whether it's web development or Facebook ads or overall digital marketing, e-commerce, whatever it is. So whenever you're hiring, you really want to figure out, hey, do I need someone to just get something done? Do I need an expert to consult? Do I really have no idea what I'm doing? I need someone to come in here and come up with a good plan? Or do I have systems and processes that I can input a basic or lower level worker and have them do it and really take it off my plate?
Right. So yeah, in my experience, I'm glad that you mentioned having these documents, because I think it's important to start out with a written document. You can do video to do, training, but having written documents also really help, like you said, until you finalize your process. And I teach people how to systematize, how to create processes and workflows so that you can manage a team. And that's one of the things I do get into a lot of detail in my programs, is how to create these step-by-step processes and create process flows that make your business efficient with the team members that you have. And I'm really big into agile, because I do come from a tech background, and I've managed multiple teams on software projects, website projects, and then digital marketing. And so the agile framework, having like business agility, in that framework, and I've done this in my own business, so I have, a team of people that are self-organizing. So it took time to get them to that place. I mean, I had to spend time training them and showing them the process. But once I got that in place, I'm able to work less hours. So they pretty much implement on an ongoing basis. I really don't have to go back and micromanage what they're doing, because I set up certain workflows that we follow on a regular basis. And then we have a system pretty much for everything now, right? So that frees up my time. And so as a business owner, I'm spending time selling instead of doing the work myself. I'm not the one that's doing the social media campaigns. I create the strategy for the campaigns. I create my level, and then I give that to my team, and then they implement that month after month. So that's just something that if you are, especially in service work, where you're doing, if you're doing consulting, or you have an agency, or you're trying to build an agency, and even for e-commerce businesses or businesses that sell products, whether they're digital or physical, you still need to have a workflow. And that's super important. So,
yeah. I completely agree. If you're a business owner, you have to be spending your time on high level stuff, marketing, sales, expansion, processes. If you're still doing the day-to-day operations, the grunt work, you got to find a way to get your time back. And really the only way to do that is by either automating with software or by hiring and outsourcing and hiring with freelancers and stuff like that.
Right. And So you have digital automation with software, like Nathan said, and that's great too. And then you can also hire people to help you set up the automation, right?
Yeah.
You have to try to figure it out yourself. Can you give me some examples of, you know, the types of people you should hire for helping you with digital automation, specific like to Upwork in your experience, or people that you know in your community?
Like, yeah, I mean, I look at it just from like the billing side of it. So billing is something that every business does it differently. For FreeUp, we bill clients every Thursday. So from our side, we had to build a software that would record people's time and then bill them every Thursday. Your business might be different. I've seen many agencies that billing it is an absolute nightmare, that they're all over the place. There's no records. They have no internal software to clock in and clock out. And sometimes you don't even have to build this stuff. You can go out there and buy it and maybe work with Xero and then work with some kind of Time Doctor software, integrate them. And it doesn't require some huge dev project, but making sure that your billing is nice, it's clean, it's easy for everyone, especially as you build your team, is huge. Then there's other things that are just day-to-day operations, maybe things that are proprietary to your business. We have one guy who runs PPC ads. Well, we have two people, one for Facebook, one for Amazon, and they hire developers to help take their strategy and really automate it so that someone gets access to this data and the software takes the data and does, I don't even know, I'm not a PPC person, but it automatically implements it in place to run these ads. So they can have a meeting with a client one-on-one, look at the data, come up with a plan, put that plan into the software, and the software automates it and then spits back out new data. So there's so many examples of automating it. If you don't have a remote developer on staff or on call or part of your team, I strongly recommend getting someone, especially once you get past that $1 million mark. It's very hard to go from one to 5 million without automating certain parts of your business.
So tell us in your experience, because what I read about you in some other interviews and seeing you do, you built your business to 5 million.
Yeah. So
maybe more.
Yeah, no, it's five. We did 5 million last year. Our run rate for FreeUp right now is between like 7 and 8. So, and I bootstrapped, and same thing with my Amazon business, totally bootstrapped. And I mean, the key is really hiring talented people. When you surround yourself with talented people, they make you look really good. They make you a lot of money. They help you cut costs. And so many business owners, they don't realize that. They look at hiring as a frustration, as something that's going to cost them money, cost them time that they don't have, when really it's the other way around. If I want to learn how to do, well, just say Facebook ads, I could spend the next 6 months learning how to do it. And I'm a reasonably intelligent person. I'm pretty confident I could figure it out, but that's not a great use of my time. So as a business owner, there's two ways that I hire. I hire for things that I don't want to be a specialist in, things that I don't have time to do, which would be the Facebook ads, the development, the overall marketing strategy. Even for me, like content, I'm not a writer. So I hire people for content, or Connor handles that. So high level stuff. And then the day-to-day stuff, what can I take off my plate so I can focus on expansion? I can talk to more clients. I can go to more conferences. And that's kind of what we talked before about, putting systems and processes and documents in place that other people can follow to free up your time back. So that's really been the key. I mean, outside of hiring, problem solving is huge, right? Every day you're dealing with something's going to happen every single day as an entrepreneur. You don't know what it is. It could be a huge fire or a small issue. And your ability to problem solve and problem solve quickly is how you scale and advance to the next level. Whether it's competing with new competition out there, whether it's an internal issue with someone, some freelancer or employee that you hired internally, whatever that is, you have to be able to gather the information, come up with different ideas for a solution, execute it, and then put steps in place so that they never happen again.
Right, right. So this is one of the biggest messages I try to get out there. I like that you mentioned this, but pretty much you did mention that a lot of new or business owners who are in that growth mode, they have a fear that if they hire someone, they're losing out, they're losing money. And you're actually not. Once you start making money, you can, you know, this is how successful business owners scale. They take a portion of that gross revenue and they reinvest it back. And they just keep reinvesting until they completely grow and expand. Can you have anything? Do you have anything to, you know, input on that topic? Because I know, you know, just in my experience working in my own company and seeing other entrepreneurs, this reinvestment, and reinvestment in this case would be outsourcing, right? So how do you, can you give some tips on that or?
Yeah, I mean, hiring is an investment. That's how you have to look at it from a business owner. And just like if you're playing with stocks and you want to invest in there, not every stock you invest in is a good investment. But if you just don't invest at all, you're going to limit yourself. You're going to hit your ceiling. So I take really a trial and error approach. When I have this money coming into my business, I'm trying lots of different things, whether it's hiring, I'm trying, hey, like, would it be good if I added a high level marketer? Would it be good if I added a content writer here? And as you get further and further down your entrepreneurial path, you'll get better at it and you'll make better investments and you'll have less losses. But sometimes you never really know unless you try something out. If you give someone a small window, and it's very similar to other parts of your business that you might invest in, whether it's, hey, like, what happens if I spend an extra $500 this week on Facebook ads? And you kind of learn, hey, was it worth it or was it not? Maybe for my business, Facebook ads doesn't make sense and I want to invest in whatever it is. So you really have to take that trial and error approach. What works for one business doesn't work for another. The hiring structure of one business doesn't necessarily work for another. You have to play around with it. You have to come up with a plan based on the information you have, and you have to continue to adjust that plan based on the results, based on the ROIs of your different investments going into different parts of your business.
Awesome. So do you have any reporting tools that you use so in my case, I like to have a weekly meeting with my team, and we look at, you know, if we're running social media campaigns, we look at metrics and some of the scheduling tools we use, like Hootsuite or Facebook has metrics that you can look at as well. Do you have any other, just maybe for your specific type of business or any type of business that you have or you've had in the past, like metrics that you can use to help you manage, you know, your business?
Yeah, so we have meetings every week as well. So we have a Monday morning meeting where everyone's in there, whether it's the accounting team, the social media team, the blog writers, my assistants, whatever it is, they're all there. And then outside of that, they have a meeting for each team each week. So the accounting team meets, the recruitment team meets, all that. And Connor and I have split it up. So he's focused on what he's good at, I'm focused on what I'm good at. And we attend the meetings that make sense to us throughout the week. And sometimes they'll even meet without us, depending on how much forward that team is. If it's a brand new team, we'll be involved in every meeting. If it's a team that's been running for a year or two, then maybe we'll come in every other meeting. So on the Monday morning meeting, it really follows the same format. We give any updates on any changes, anything we feel like people should know, keeping people informed, incredibly important. We talk about last week, how it was, whether it was it good, was it bad, what problems did we have. If it was a great week, we tell everyone and we congratulate them, keep them motivated. Then we talk about the week ahead. Hey, these are the upcoming podcasts, the upcoming opportunities we have. Hey, watch out for this. Whatever it is, giving people a future ahead of what the goals are, what the expectations are for the week. And then we have each team provide updates. And that's where the numbers come in that you were just talking. So the accounting team will make a post. Hey, last week we billed X amount of clients. Here's the percentage growth or loss. And then they'll give us more numbers that came along with it. X amount paid with credit card, X amount, whatever. Then the recruitment team will go, hey, we got X amount of applicants last week. We accepted these amount. It was for these skill sets. We're running low on this. And we'll go through the numbers together. And same thing with the blog writers and the social media. We'll talk about the engagement and the clicks. And that's when the numbers come in. So we let each team be responsible for their numbers. And as they post it, other people will chime in being like, oh, you know what? Let's say we were short on writers, on recruiting for writers. And my assistants noticed there's a big demand for writers, and the recruitment people, they have no writers in the pipeline. That's when, hey, the marketing, the social media people jump in. Okay, now I take note of that. My focus this week is going to be getting more writers to apply for the marketplace. So you kind of engage the whole team together, where you focus on each team one by one going through, and everyone else uses what they can do, taking those numbers to implement them on their team to help every other team out. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. This is what I've been doing for the past 10 years. Really manage. And so what you're talking about is really program management, which is crucial for a business, especially one of your size, or as you are adding a lot of people on, as you scale, you need to have this program level view, portfolio view, And so there are specific reports that you can create, which every team will give you, and you kind of create a dashboard view. That kind of goes at, but you need, obviously, the next situation, you have a lot of people in your organization, but that's very important. And that's more, like I said, program and portfolio management. So do you have any tips for how to really motivate your team to create, you know, it seems like the way you described your organization, people are, you know, kind of like by posting and sharing all this, they seem to be motivating each other, right? So what do you do? Do you do anything specific to kind of create that culture in your organization?
Yeah, so it starts at the beginning, figuring out what your culture is, what you want it to be, and only letting people in that fit and match that culture, right? Because it only takes one bad apple to make the whole thing start spiraling out of control. So half the battle is only letting people in that you know that you can motivate, that are positive, and that will help motivate other people. Then once they're in, people want to know how the work that they're doing, how that's contributing to the business. No one wants to be handed a piece of paper and say, do this project. They turn it in. You give them a new piece of paper and you say, do this. They turn it in and they have no idea what they're doing or why they're doing it or how it impacts your business or your company in any way. The way to go about it is you keep everyone involved in the goals. Hey, our goal is to build X amount of hours. Our goal is to sell X amount of products. Our goal is to get 2 new clients this week, whatever it is. And even if they're a one-time graphic designer, they know what the goals are because they're motivated by that. They want to contribute and be a part of something. And then on top of that, you keep people informed. Information is power. Just like when we're going through this meeting, and social media people now want to hear what the accounting people are saying. They want to hear what the blog writers are saying. They now care. They're invested in it. They want to see progression week to week and that it's growing and that every team's doing better. We give updates. We tell them about like meetings that Connor and I have that are very high level. We keep them informed. And that is incredibly important. People want information. They want to know what's going on. They want to know what goals are. And when they hit goals, when they finish a project, they want recognition. And that recognition could be either money or it could be giving them recognition in front of other people. So our developers have been working on this software update for 6 months. We launched it last Sunday. The new client UI looks incredible. I'm so pumped for it. We gave them huge recognition during the week. They did an awesome job and they deserve it. And obviously money will follow with it. I just got back from the Philippines. I think you contacted me when I was in the Philippines. We took our team out to a resort. We bought them meal after meal. We got them massages. We went to the beach with them. And obviously that's the extreme. And hopefully you guys get your businesses to that point. But it all starts with letting in the right people, having productive meetings, giving people great feedback or productive feedback and goals and expectations, and then figuring out new, unique ways to let people know that you appreciate their hard work.
That is awesome. So tell us about your recent trip to the Philippines and, like, you know, some of the things you did to kind of, like you said, expand upon your, you know, create that company culture and that team feeling, you know, we're all in this together type of thing. I saw some of the pictures you posted, which are really cool. They're on your Facebook page, right?
Yeah. I think you said you've been outsourcing for 10 years. I've been outsourcing for about 6. I was hiring people before that. So I have some people that I've been working with for 6 years that I had never met in person that I've gotten to know very well on both a business and a professional level. So we had actually set a goal that if we had billed 5,000 hours, this was last year, now we bill over 10,000, but we said, hey, if we hit 5,000 hours, Connor and I are getting on a plane, we're heading to the Philippines, and we'll meet up with all of you. And so we hit it way faster than we thought, talk about motivating people and getting people to contribute for the greater good. And so we went out there, and there were two purposes. One, we had our internal team, which is 10 to 20 people, and not all of them are in the Philippines, but we were like, hey, we'll take you guys out. Like, this is, we came up with a really good plan, nice resort, great food, beaches, the massage that I mentioned. This would treat them well. But then we also put on an event, and we were essentially like, hey, no pressure, no obligation. We'll have food. We'll have drinks. We'll put on a talk. We'll take pictures of the guys. Whoever wants to come, you're more than welcome to. Here's a day, time, address. And we had over 100 people show up, and they could bring their families. And Connor and I would take silly pictures with them, and we recorded the whole thing. It's on my Facebook if you want to watch it. We obviously gave a talk. We recognized our internal team in front of everyone else, put some faces, some names. So these are the people that freelancers in the network interact with on a daily basis. So it was cool for a lot of them to meet. It was a great networking opportunity, meeting people that maybe three freelancers work for the same client. They'd never met in person before. So it was really cool. And we just had an unbelievable time. People there are so nice, so welcoming, and we couldn't ask for better people. And besides the jet lag when I got back, the entire trip was great.
Yeah, awesome. I don't know how you keep up with all these different time zone schedules. Well, you probably have your VA or a team member helping you, right? So.
Yeah, I mean, everyone's on either a schedule unless they don't have to, unless it's like something like graphic design where it's just due dates. But I mean, we have people that work U.S. times, people that work Filipino times. Part of the thing about being in business nowadays with online business is your business is always running. And one of the benefits for having an outsourced team as you get bigger and bigger is you can make the business run and continue to move forward even when you're not online.
Yes, exactly. So that's wonderful. And that's one of the perks of having an online business and working for yourself. So this is great. Thank you so much. You shared so much value with us and we've learned so much today with you. So tell us, where can we how can we sign up for Free Up? Tell us about the process and the link. And I'll actually post the link in this video.
Cool. So here's the deal. It's free to sign up. There's no monthly fee. There's no minimums. There's no obligation. You can end the agreement with us at any time. It's in our best interest to get you people that you actually like, that help free up your time, that help you grow and advance your business. If you go to freeup.com with three E's, my calendar is right at the top. I'd love to meet with any of you about what you have going on in your business, answer any questions you have, and help you put together a good either team or group of freelancers to help you move forward, whether it's US or non-US. You can also click become a client, create a free account. You can request a worker, meet with the worker before you ever add a payment method. We're all on the same side here looking to help each other. And if you want more hiring content, check out freeup.com/blog. We're always posting content about hiring, about outsourcing, about motivating, everything possible to give you the resources you need to grow your business.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, Nathan, for sharing this information with us.
Thanks so much for having me.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye.